Dr. Bruce Sweden, welcome everybody here. It's a great honor to have so many people here. Thank you for coming to the EVTM Symposium. We see it as a new platform to use for exchange of knowledge, communicate with each other, and cooperation. I would like to thank all the people helping us here, the Örebro University, our hospital, Örebro Hospital, the community, the ATLS Foundation, Tokai, which is our main sponsor for the event, the company from Japan of the rescue balloon. I will speak about it later, but to visit also the industry, our friends there, they help us a lot, and without them, it's impossible to do this. I would like to invite first three persons that will welcome you. It's Professor Göran Wallin, Professor Lars Nogren, and Dr. Mattias Sandin. Göran Wallin is the head of the surgical division here. Lars Nogren is our former chief of vascular and general surgery. And Mattias is the head of the cardiothoracic and vascular surgery. He's an anesthetist. And I would like them to come up to say some words. Thank you.
So on behalf of the Örebro University and the Örebro University Hospital, it's really a great pleasure to see so many people here. And it's fantastic that Tal managed to get them all here. Then Sweden is a long and narrow country, and we've just passed 10 million people, so we're not so well populated. And we've had very few traumas and gunshots. So that has changed a little bit the last 10, 20 years. But I spent 2 years in St. Louis in the beginning of the 90s. And when I arrived, they asked me about gunshots, and I'd seen 2 in 14 years. And that was both of them accidents in hunting. But now it has changed a little bit, even in Sweden. But our university is the youngest university in Sweden, and it's going on very well. And after this meeting, I think it will be even better and a good publicity for the university. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you very much. And dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, as emeritus professor and former head of the Department of Surgery, I'm very proud to see the rapid and recent development of research and practical activities related to EVMT that are seen at Örebro University and University Hospital. Actually, it was as late as 2007 we were able to open up our experimental animal department that has been run by two enthusiasts, Dr. Hörer and Dr. Skog. And in parallel, we had the clinical development led by Dr. Larsson. Thanks to all those efforts, and in particular the work by Tal Hörer, it's now possible today to welcome you to this, the very first EVMT symposium. The impressive program raises numbers of important questions. And based on the fact that you all, including world-renowned experts, have accepted the invitation to be here, to come and present and discuss, I'm personally very convinced there will be a very high level of both academic and practical debate and discussion in this room and outside. And this is, at the end, to the benefit of our patients. I think that's very, very important. So thank you for coming, and I wish the meeting all success.
Yeah, well, on behalf of the Department of Cardiothoracic and Vascular Surgery, I will also welcome you here to Örebro to this symposium. I hope you are as excited as I am, and I'm sure we are going to have a couple of days with nice, interesting talks, discussions, and hopefully a lot of exchange experience about the subject. But even if the symposium hasn't started yet, I would like to say a few thanks. And the first is thanks to the organizing committee for extremely nice work you have done to make this possible. Thank you very much for that. I would also like to thank the sponsors for the Congress, so for this symposium. Without you, we wouldn't be able to stand here today. But last, but not least, I would send a special thank you to Tal Hörer. Without your extremely enthusiasm, your energy, and extremely hard work, and using a lot of your spare time, we wouldn't be able to stand here today. Thank you very much, Tal, and once again, welcome.
Thank you so much, and thank you for the warm words. I just want to say some words. I want to keep it short. EVTM, endovascular hybrid trauma and bleeding management. So we're not talking only about trauma. We're talking about, and not talking only about an endovascular technique. We're talking about also hybrid techniques. So how these tools can be used. And when I mean tools, that's the whole idea. You have a toolbox, and you can use them. And by getting a multidisciplinary approach, learning from our colleagues, you can do a lot of things you never knew it's possible. Our aim with this symposium is to do it a bit differently. We want to cooperate, we want to exchange knowledge. So we go away from the ego that's mine, that's yours, and we try to collaborate, and I hope it will work. Some technical details. We have our students here, medical students. They are standing on the sides, and they have microphones. And I would like to encourage everybody to speak as much as you want within the time limits. So just raise your hand when you want to say something. And we don't want people to be quiet and just accept what I said or someone else. We will debate it. That's the idea. Another comments is you will see a timer on the screen, and all the PowerPoints will close down on the designated time. I apologize to all of you for this, but if you have 15 minutes, it will close down at 15 minutes, and this is in order to get it right and get the program running. We aim at cooperation and exchanging knowledge, and I really hope that this is a start of something. It's a lot of projects going on, as you saw, like Top Stance, the JVTM, the EVTM Society, this meeting, and a lot of research, and I hope we can do together a lot of things. I want also to present the chairs of this symposium, and just to present them by name so you will know who they are. They help us with building the scientific part. I will start just to mention Todd Rasmussen, if you can raise your hand here. Joe DuBois, somewhere here. George Osthuizen, should be here somewhere. There up, all right. Boris Kessel. Laurie Handelin. June Matsumoto. Johnny Morrison. And Victor Reva. Thank you all for your help with building this, and I hope we will have a good meeting. We will try to keep the times, and I think we will just start. Mm-hmm. Artai?
So thank I would you. Like to welcome you here as well to Örebro. Let me just go ahead with the presentation of our first lecture holder, Professor Ken Beaufort. He's the Professor Emeritus at the University of the Witwatersrand and the Trauma Director at Mill Park Hospital in Johannesburg. And currently he's a visiting professor in Sahlgrenska University Hospital in Örebro. Please.
Thank you very much indeed, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. It's slightly cooler than South Africa. They're both 24 degrees, one's in Fahrenheit and one's in centigrade. I was asked to cover military and civilian advances across the board, and the first thing I did is wrote to all my trauma surgeon colleagues and said, what are the three most important advances? And nobody could really agree. Going back to the flying, Orville Wright said, if you're looking for safety, do nothing. His brother said, if I tried to predict the future, I would have screwed up, so I don't make any predictions. And let me give you some sort of example, because realistically, this is our situation. I'm not sure who's the trauma surgeon and who is the patient, but this is our situation. We started off about 7,000 years ago, and we're really looking at the last 15 years. So the first question, what is the world's oldest profession? This is not directed at the young ladies in the audience, because the reality is it's surgery, not the other one. Firstly, you have to make women. So the surgeon is the first profession, and some of the mindsets that sometimes go with it, and that's one of the fun things about this meeting. First recorded surgery that was successful was Buchholz for letting out psychiatric illness 8,000 years ago. You can see evidence of healing at 6,000 years ago. They were still doing it in the 15th century, still letting out feelings. The Brits developed instruments to do it in 1525. Ambroise Paré started things, and then in 1640 they were still making holes. So something that had 7,000 years of tradition to let psychiatric vapors out. Question, what will they be thinking of Reboa in 7,000 years' time? So this is how we have evolved in trauma care, and what are the key things that have happened? First x-rays ever used for trauma were actually in combat. But what's happening this century? And the reality is we've refined the surgery. Nothing has really advanced in the last decade that is surgical. The dynamics have changed. Pre-hospital, most of the deaths were pre-hospital. Now the deaths are in hospital and they're primarily from bleeding. And that's where the commonest mortality comes. So all our efforts realistically is to stop the bleeding. Now, blood transfusions got lots of diseases, lots of antibodies, lots of reactions. It's never there when you want it. It's never new. It never carries oxygen. And it's like marriage. Should you enter into it more often than absolutely necessary? So what I'm going to talk about primarily, sorry about the pun, is how do we prevent? How do we stop the injury from happening in the first place? Secondarily, if it is going to happen, how do we minimize the damage? And that's the obvious sort of thing. And then thirdly, what else do we do? So transfusion bought us time, started in the First World War. Tertiary prevention is to redesign to stop further injury, and unfortunately the bull could be regarded as too many hospitals in too many countries. So it's education, that kept on coming back, both pre-hospital in the emergency room and the DSTC, DATC courses. And I'm going to be throwing up, and these are the advances, and I'm just going to highlight some of these advances. One of the things that shocked me about working in Sweden is what could be regarded as the overuse of CT scan. Now, this was a paper from Germany, so clearly Germans, having invented quite a lot of the current equipment for CT scan, believe in it, saying it's wonderful for everything, even if the blood pressure is 40. But the British NICE guidelines, National Institute of Clinical Excellence, and this is all from the last year, say immediate chest x-ray and or FAST is part of the primary survey for chest trauma. And use the clinical findings to direct not only whether you need a CT, but what kind of CT. You do not need to reposition. Tell your radiologists they don't have to lift the hands for the torso and then put them down for the neck. You do not need that. And there is clear evidence, and that's the REACT-2 trial, showing that CT scanning does not reduce hospital mortality in any other way, but unfortunately dramatically increases the radiation. Two CT scans equates to Fukushima power station. How many of you with a hand on your heart would say, I don't do two CT scans on a trauma patient? It's got advantages, quality of images and so on, but the more sophisticated the scanner, the longer it takes to read. And there are the radiation doses. Now, one of the things we're trying to do is minimize time and everything else, and I just draw your attention, anybody wants to look at it can look at LODOX, low-dose X-ray, which looks like that. It's an X-ray machine. It's not a scanner. It does a whole body scan in 13 seconds and fits into a container if you want. Militarily, that is one of the single biggest advances we've got, because 13 seconds after the patient is put in, you have that. You can see every fracture. This guy needs a nasogastric tube, and you can also pick up the scaphoids in 13 seconds. Here's a chap who fell on a pole. In 13 seconds, we know which cavity we're operating on first. 13 seconds after they come in. So where does Reboa fit into all of this? Just to redefine, Reboa placement is in three zones. One, up to the celiac, from the top down to the celiac artery. Second, between celiac and the renal. And usually we try not to occlude that part of the world. And then zone three is the lowest. So where is the evidence? And this is the current thing from Jean Moore in, it's actually a 2017 article. Pre-hospital Reboa. Any pre-hospital patient with CPR requires a resuscitative thoracotomy in the ED, dependent on times. It goes on to say, what is the role? And remember, this is the evidence as reported in the Journal of Trauma currently, and comes from Walt Biffle. Thoracic hemorrhage. If the BP is less than 60, despite initial fluid challenge, they need a thoracotomy in the ED. If the BP is more than 80, it should be in the OR. And between 60 and 80, you can make a case for where you do it, depending on your facilities. In the thoracic hemorrhage area, the problem is very simply that if you inflate the Reboa below the hole, you increase the pressure above the hole and make it bleed more. Is there a role for Reboa in abdominal hemorrhage? Greater than 80, they should go straight to the OR. With a blood pressure of less than 80 and a delay in the OR, this is probably the situation. But I'm going to stick my neck out, and I was talking to Todd a little earlier. I don't think, as we speak here, Reboa can yet be defined as an advance in trauma. We used to think Buchholz for psyche was good. I think there's no question that when this meeting takes place in 2018 or 2020 or 2024, the feeling will be very different. But I think we're still refining the equipment, and I think we're still refining the techniques, and most important of all, I think we're still refining the collection. And again, my compliments to Tal, simply for highlighting what we need to refine. Pelvic hemorrhage, just remember, 85% of pelvic bleeding is venous. By putting in a Reboa, you may push up the intrathoracic pressure. By pushing up the intrathoracic pressure, you push up the intra-abdominal pressure, and you increase venous bleeding. There's no free lunches in this world. And so the recommendation of this paper, we recommend against broad application of Reboa in the absence of data. Your job and my job and our job is to produce that data which gives us the favorable profile. I think the biggest advance that I've seen is goal-directed hemostasis, viscoelastic studies, the control of bleeding so you don't need you don't need to give blood. We've understood for the first time, and this came from Mitch Cohen, what the coagulopathy is, and from Karim Broey. We've looked at TEG and a ROTEM, and most of the pioneering work came from this part of the world, particularly from Denmark. ROTEM and TEG and Jakob Stensballer and Per Johansson and so on. And I think most centers now would run their entire hemostasis based on one or other of the viscoelastics. Next question, tranexamic acid. Is there a place for it? I'm going to stick my neck out and say no, there is no routine place. If you use a trial based entirely in developing countries and place that trial into a developed country, the current evidence for pre-hospital tranexamic acid says that there is no definitive evidence, and this came from Lena Napolitano again in the Journal of Trauma this year. No definitive evidence to support routine use of TXA. We don't know which patients will benefit. Jean Moore's own paper showed all trauma patients start off as hypercoagulable. The challenge is which patients are going to need it, which patients are going to need Reboa. I'm not going to say very much about damage control, other than to say it's exactly the same thing. The president of the American College of Surgeons in 1969 said there is no place in modern surgery for packing. 10 years later, he came back and said, if you have your bollocks cut off for doing it, it's okay. And damage control done wrongly is destructive. This is a picture of the Titanic. You can see the damage control bulkheads. Unfortunately, they're all in the front of the ship. So when they filled up with water, the weight broke the ship. Damage control applied badly is not damage control. The USS Cole was blown up in Aden. That's the hole. Except for the crewmen who were inside, everyone else have survived. The ship was brought back to the US, and to be honest, my greatest admiration is for the Norwegian vessel that you could put an entire American ship on top of. Nice paper. Opinions of practicing surgeons on the appropriateness of published indications. And they came up, and I would refer you to this paper if you're doing damage control, 2016, 15 preoperative indications and 23 operative indications. What about stents? Well, they're pretty well described now. They work very well. One doesn't go into them too much. What about infection control and septic markers? This is something we should all be doing. And I quote the president of the College of Surgeons 116 years ago. And anyone who is in 2017 using CRP, C-reactive protein, as a marker in trauma should go back and have a discussion with Noah in his ark. Because the reality is it has no place to play in 2017. Procalcitonin is probably the best marker for infection in trauma. CRP is just a waste of money. ECMO, I think ECMO has found its role. ECMO has been shown particularly in patients with ARDS and patients with inhalation and burns to have made a significant contribution. What about military? Well, I'm going to finish off, and I think my video clip, and I don't know how I can do a mouse on this, so maybe it's not going to work, to say the biggest advance in military has actually been two things. One is the mobile evacuation, and the second is mine-proof vehicles. But I can't actually trigger the video. Or maybe I can. Anyone know Top Gear? That's what happens if you blow up a Hummer with a standard standard IED under the road. This is Richard Hammond.
Yeah. Really not much point trying to see if it will start because some pretty important bits are missing.
So the H3 is, like Hummer itself, very dead. But the important question is, what happens to the Marauder when you put the same amount of explosives underneath it?
This is known as an MRAP in America.
Right, well, clearly what's happened here is there was a fight between the Marauder and the Earth, and the Earth lost, and the explosion has just dug a big hole. Okay, fingers crossed. That was definitely an inconvenience, but really nothing more.
Bottom line is we have to prevent the trauma if we can. We have to minimize that. The biggest advances in trauma in the year up to 2017 have not been in the field of surgery. They have been in the field of stopping the bleeding. They have been in the field of non-operative management. And in the areas of those patients who get hurt, they're in the areas of getting them to proper care in an appropriate place as quickly as possible. Robur may have a role in it. Challenge. Let's define it. Thank you.
Now let's move on with the next. It's Professor Todd Rasmussen, Colonel Todd Rasmussen. He's the director of the Combat Casualty Care Research Program in Fort Detrick, Maryland, and is also a professor of surgery in Uniformed Services University, Bethesda in Maryland. Please.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and Dr. Boffard, thank you for your sage comments and the challenge that's issued at the beginning of this great event. I would like to step to the next topic then and talk about arcs of progress. And I think Dr. Boffard gave a good summary of the need to advance where we have been and where we may be today. But I'd like to take the opportunity and talk about the arc of progress as it pertains to a couple of different factors that will be on display over the next couple of days. Tal, thank you for having us here. As a matter of my disclosures, I am a co-holder of patent technology for the Reboa catheter and design, but I have no financial or corporate consulting agreements or conflicts of interest to disclose. And importantly, while I am active duty military, the views that I express are mine as a clinician and scientist and not those of the United States Department of Defense. So the arc of progress as it pertains to vascular injury and vascular trauma, resuscitation, and hemorrhage control was laid out here by Ken Maddox, Norman Rich, Dr. Jonathan Woodson, and myself in 2011. And today I'd like to talk about the arc of progress as it pertains to access and endovascular technology, so the technologies themselves. I want to introduce or elaborate or develop a topic called selective torso perfusion or regional tissue optimization in the torso, because I think as we look at the future aspects of the arc of progress, that will be important. The arc of the clinical setting, progress as to where these technologies will be applied. Right now, primarily in operating theaters and resuscitation rooms, but where in the future will that arc take us? And then is on display here, the arc of collaboration, both multidisciplinary collaboration among different fields of surgery and medicine, but also international collaboration that Tal and the team have done such a nice job of bringing together here. I do want to take just a few slides and talk about pre-1950, some of the history of where this arc may have began, and then talk about where we are now, somewhere around the 2000, 2015, 17 area, and then where we stand to be in the coming 20 years or so. This is a photograph of the famous Russian surgeon, military surgeon, Nikolai Pirogov. And I think he was the founder of Russian field surgery and really international field surgery. And in the late 1800s offered this insight and may really have been, with some license at least, foretelling the advances of endovascular surgery when he said a new era for surgery will become if we would manage to stop the flow of major artery quickly and surely without its exploration and ligation. And so while he did not mention catheter-based techniques, it doesn't take much imagination to say that at the beginning of the arc of this progress, he was foretelling this. I want to thank Victor Riva for providing me this quote and then display the two sources of the textbooks, The Beginning of Common War Surgery that Pirogov edited that in the late 1800s, 1866, to be specific, first in German and then in Russian, where this quote was found. Victor, thank you for providing me these images. Also early in the arc of progress from the United States side is then Lieutenant Colonel Carl Hughes, who went on to be a major general later in his career and a surgeon and leader, really mentor of Norman Rich. And in the reports from his time during the Korean War published the use of an endovascular balloon in three or four cases in this article in Surgery 1954. And in there, he said probably each of these patients would have had better chance for survival if the catheter had been used earlier. And he concluded it's felt that more work is needed in this. So these are two foundational papers or quotes at the early stage of this arc of technology process or progress. We've written, this was last year's January cover of Endovascular Today, in which we have described, and I'll refer you to your reading, the evolution of endovascular capability in the wartime setting. And we acknowledge that largely the advances that were made or have been made were based on the effectiveness of these techniques in managing vascular disease, aneurysm disease, occlusive disease of the coronaries and the periphery. So we're midway through this arc of progress, if you will, and I think, as you'll hear over the next couple of days, we won't just talk about REBOA or the opportunities with endovascular control of the aorta, but also other methods to control bleeding and seal or fix vascular injury or disruption, and we'll hear about those over the next couple of days. So if you look at the arc of progress specifically as it pertains to REBOA and REBOA-like technologies, on the left is the catheter and glass syringe that Carl Hughes used in combat setting in the 1950s, the Blakemore and Lord Vitalium tubes, the intravascular tubes that were used at the early part of the 20th century to manage vascular disruption. There are now, as we've moved along, technologies like the selective aortic arch perfusion. This is a paper from Jim Mannings. There is the COTA balloon and other endovascular balloons that are used, you know, compliant balloons to manage placement of endografts. There is new technology that is designed to be more useful in the setting of trauma. This is an early, very early prototype of the current ER REBOA catheter, which is shown here. And then where will we be in the future, 10 years from now, 5 or 10 years from now? I think that our endovascular technologies will be miniaturized. They'll be autonomous, either decision-supported or decision-guided. They'll have autonomous. They will have an element of selective aortic control. It won't be all or nothing, but we will be able to isolate aspects of branch vessel flow from the aorta. They will be associated with metabolic stabilization, either physical cooling of the patient or regions of the viscera, or administration of medications or cells, stem or stromal cells. And I think they will also be able to have a seamless incorporation in the future with extracorporeal organ support, either active or passive filtration. This is midway through this arc of progress. This is the ER REBOA catheter that most of you know about, which is now CE marked and FDA cleared and set for clinical study to get some of the data that Professor Boffard challenges us to get. The next, I think, step in this arc of progress is depicted here, looking at methods to give partial aortic occlusion. This is the ER REBOA Pro, or the partial ER REBOA catheter with the ability. This is actually not that. This depicts here the central lumen using the existing ER REBOA catheter, where really it's all or nothing. You either have the balloon all the way up, and there's very little control. There's no fine-tuning of flow around that balloon. But next, this is the ER REBOA Pro catheter, which shows it's really a dual balloon design with the same compliant balloon, but a buddy balloon or a partner balloon that is non-compliant or less compliant. And when inflated, opens flow channels that allows immediate and fine-tuned control and partial REBOA, as we have described. And you'll hear more about this throughout the day, but this is, I think, next in the arc of progress for partial REBOA. And I think this is for the first time on this slide, I will mention the phrase of selective perfusion optimization or regional perfusion optimization, where we don't have to have supernormal blood pressures above the balloon and ischemia below the balloon, but we can have REBOA technologies that allow us to adjust either in a manual or autonomous mode flow around the balloon through channels such as this. This is the REBOA Pro balloon, and I mentioned it has two balloons. This is a prototype of that. It is by Prytime Medical. It's a compliant balloon. It's still a 7 French catheter. the same tip, but then it has this spine balloon or partner balloon that opens those channels and allows one to control flow both above and below the balloon as it's inflated. I think this gives us a sort of an insight into the arc of perfusion, precision perfusion, whereas at the beginning in 5 to 10, 20, 50 years ago, it was either global hypotension and shock and immediate open hemostasis. Really, those were the only options. Along this arc, we have talked about and developed permissive hypotension and then maybe delayed hemostasis, operative hemostasis. And we are now, I think, in this situation where we right now have REBOA, which is all occlusion or nothing, which is not the endpoint on this arc. I think future REBOA, I've mentioned the partial REBOA or REBOA Pro catheter. I think Tim Williams and some of the group from his lab will talk about endovascular variable aortic control, which is an automated form of balloon inflation and deflation. And I think that is not far in this arc of progress. We will also maybe hear from Jim Manning and his selective aortic arch perfusion. And I think eventually we will have endovascular selective side branch control and metabolic manipulation. So selective regional tissue perfusion optimization. And so I think this is along this arc of progress that we should look for in the coming, coming 5 to 10 years. To the left being gross and no selective perfusion optimization and need for imminent open repair, to now on the far end and more progressed side, more precise selective perfusion optimization, and then extended period of time until the operation is needed or performed. So a selective regional perfusion optimization, here's a series of slides here that try to articulate this as we develop it. This is certainly where we are now. There is really no selective regional perfusion optimization today. Right now the balloon is either up, giving good or supernormal perfusion above the balloon and suboptimal perfusion below it. We do have, with Jim Manning's work in selective aortic arch perfusion, the concept of perfusing above the balloon and maybe even perfusing with whole blood or oxygen carriers below the balloon. That is being developed now. Maybe using an oxygen carrier to perfuse and promote oxygen delivery below the balloon. And then connecting these devices or associated them with ECMO or ECMO-like technologies. And I think this will help us to, it's not all or nothing. We pick the regional bed that we want to perfuse and then the area that is bleeding, we keep it from bleeding or keep it isolated. This shows the ER REBOA Pro catheter, or the REBOA Pro catheter, again, the compliant balloon, looking at control around the balloon in a limited fashion, and hopefully this and technologies like it, aortic sleeves, retractable stents, partial stent coverage or lining of the aorta, will allow us then to isolate different areas and branch vessels of the aorta so that we don't have an all or nothing phenomenon in the future when it comes to resuscitative endovascular balloon occlusion. It will be selective and we can optimize perfusion to different beds of the viscera in the future. I think there's the arc of progress and the setting of use. We'll have debate and discussion about this throughout the days. I think on the left, we really started with this technology isolated to facility-based in operating theaters by surgeons primarily. I think this will evolve to facility-based resuscitation rooms, critical care settings and down in the emergency department, and as we'll hear over the next couple of days, pre-hospital and en route care use. And then for the U.S. military, certainly, and as I'll visit, talk about tomorrow, even taking this near or close to the point of injury, closer to the bedside of the bleeding or shocked patient. And I think we will evolve, and we'll discuss this evolution of the arc of progress for setting of care over the next couple of days. For us in the military, we had the experience published here looking at our first endovascular catheter-based technology in an austere setting. This is followed up and will be presented by Joe DeBose tomorrow, I believe, the first in-theater use of the REBOA catheter, the ER REBOA catheter, in an austere military setting for patients in shock. And Joe will elaborate on this case report, which is in press now with the Journal of Special Operations Medicine. Arc of collaboration, I think we see this on display here. Good timing, the cover of this month's or last month's Endovascular Today features the team approach to hemorrhage control, and I'll refer you to their website. We started, I think, with individual specialties siloed in their own countries and their own medical centers. We're evolving now to include international collaborations, and I think as we evolve along this arc, we'll have cross-specialty collaboration, international collaboration, as we see here, and then importantly, robust private and public innovation and investment, which is really necessary to have private investment and innovation to drive this technology transformation. I will finish with this slide. Dr. Norman Rich sends his best to this group. We have had several decades of collaboration among many in this room. We published the vascular third edition of Rich's Vascular Trauma last year or the year before. And I just want to mention that there are probably five or six chapter authors or collaborators listed here: Bofford, Inaba, Samokvalov, DuBose, Riva, Morrison, Fox, and Starnes, who will be here with us today in the next couple of days, all contributed to this textbook as I illustrate this arc of collaboration together. I'll finish there and say thank you right as the bell rings. This is a coin. This is our Department of Defense Combat Casualty Care coin that we display here. And on one side, it says from science to the battlefield. And on the other, it says for combat wounded. Everything we do in our job is for that. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here and look forward to a great couple of days. Thank you.
Now, the next lecture is held by Dr. Thomas Larsson. He's a vascular surgeon, and he's the former chief of the vascular unit in Örebro University Hospital. And I and Tal had the honor to have him as a mentor. Please.
Thank you, Artai, and also a special thank to you, Tal. I'm so proud of you in the way you have executed this challenge. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, my title is Time for the Paradigm Shift in Hemorrhage Control. What can we learn from the past? And my disclosures, this is not running. Can you help me with that? Okay, thank you. This is my disclosure, nothing in conflict with what I am going to talk about. An important milestone was this publication from Frank Wheat, published in 2009, where he had gathered data from centers, excellent centers doing ruptured aneurysms with EVAR. And this study came up with a result that was very good for EVAR, with a 19-20% mortality rate compared with 36 for open repair. And it also showed that aortic balloon occlusion has a role. Of course, this was criticized as registers. The criticism was this is cherry picking. And however, we could show that centers that used a standardized protocol and local anesthesia had fluid restriction and balloon control had better results. So when did it start? When was the first EVAR performed in a ruptured aneurysm? And when was the first balloon implanted? So this is the first case, and it was also done by Frank Wheat and his group in New York. It was a patient with a contained rupture having an aortouni iliac stent graft like this. This was very common in the early days. And as you see, this stent is mounted on a balloon, a stent is mounted on the balloon and connected to the fabrics. This has disappeared in favor for femoral stent grafts, but I think aortouni iliac stent graft has value in a trauma situation. We performed a couple of years later our first balloon occlusion on a patient with a ruptured AAA during CPR, simultaneous CPR. We had a real high zone one placement of the balloon, as you can see, and the outcome was very good. The patient survived and had many happy years. And this, of course, kick-started us doing our program for ruptured aneurysm, and our early results showed very good results. You can see that a majority of the patients was in hemodynamic shock, and we used the aortic balloon very frequently and had a good outcome in the mortality, 30-day mortality. We used two balloons, one actually place supraceliac, low zone 3 or maybe a zone 2 placement. And as soon as possible, when we have the main stent graft in place, we inserted a stent graft in zone 3, and we could have a medium time of occlusion of the visceral and renal segments with 40 minutes. This is another important milestone article, because the criticism during these early days was that you just choose the good patients. So what's the way to argue against such standpoints? Yeah, you treat all of them, and you take all comers to EVAR. And that's this publication shows, together with the Zurich Center. We have Soren Ransicki today. He was part of that trial, and we could show that with permissive hypertension, with balloon occlusion optional, using local anesthesia, we could treat hemodynamic unstable patient and still have a good 30-day mortality. And as I said, almost no patients was rejected. So this was not cherry picking. This was the results of all comers. To do all comers, you need adjunct techniques, and the techniques we presented in 2005, the chimney technique, it's actually what Todd says, it's a chimney technology he will use in the Rebuba in the future. I'm very glad, because this is the first publication of a chimney case. We use it frequently in ruptured EVAR, and we also use chimney technique when it comes to transection. It's a good way to put in a chimney stent, it is subclavian, and have a good landing zone proximal. And we have other techniques, of course. We have all the materials, the coils, the plugs, and the liquid embolic glue and onyx. And actually, you can do with these adjunct techniques, you can use that as a single treatment. This is a type 1 endoleak after EVAR with a rupture, treated successfully with just onyx. So the question is, are there enough data from the ruptured aneurysm so we can say that this can be applicable in trauma? That's the question. I will say yes, but we need more. We need new aortic smart balloons. Todd has talked about that nicely. I think we need balloons that can communicate, that can work in a pre-hospital setting. We need new positioning systems. When we are close to the field, we have no X-ray. We need to know better about pressure and perfusion. What should be done in the emergency department and pre-hospital, we need protocols. Altogether, we need to extend the golden hour. We will buy time. Cooling might be of benefit. It has also harm. We will see. But these guys coming here together, you are the ones that will push the envelope and see what comes up in the future. Much will come up. Now, this was the specialized device-orientated talk. Now we'll give you the big picture. The big picture is Bandage 2004, Haiti 2010, Nice 2016. What are the resources we can use better? The low-tech solutions. How can the public contribute? Because they are on the field. That's the only one who are on the field. How can we educate them? What is the political will, and what economic incentives can we find?
It's about 100 links. Wait, says he's all used up.
Move on to somebody you can help.
Let's go.
He's battalion surgeon, sir.
That is a kitchen.
Wait.
Stop the bleeding. I made a survey in my hospital. What do you do if you find a person with a pulsative bleeding from the neck? I got the same answer from everyone. I will compress. Pressure on it. Well, yes, But then I say, next to you, there is another one bleeding from a limb. This is a terror attack. But you are locked to that patient. How many of you can do a neck wrap? A good first aid help is when you can take something you bear, you have a shirt or something like that, and with the patient's other hand, you can have a unilateral compression, and you can use the hand of the patient to give the pressure, even better pressure on the wounded side. During the Great War, every stretch bearer, every officer, and each man, if possible, should now know how to fix a garrot. During the First War, that cost a lot of limbs, but it saved lives. So when the patient comes in, these are very sophisticated pressurized bandage, but you don't have it on the field, on the beach, you don't have them. So what do you have? Maybe you have a scarf or a shirt or something like that. And you don't have a sword as they had at Fort Alamo, but you have a shoe, or at least you have a cell phone and can do a tourniquet. But how do we educate people? How can we educate them? When I was born in 1950, post-Second War, on the wardrobe, I had instructions in my home on the wardrobe. Instruction on how to do when the war comes. What to do when the atomic bomb is dropped. And you had it everywhere. Everywhere you had these signs. But you know, science is of no value because they are never at the right site when you need them. But what always is it's the cell phone, and it's all the app technology that will come in the future that can, it's extreme possibility to educate the public. Now.
I said, let's go! Expected, morphine. Priority. He's gone.
He's gone. Well, who will live and who will die? What is the political will? Tahiti, 2010. 200,000 people died, 300,000 people were injured, and 1.5 million were displaced. For example, in tent camps, as you see on this picture. So, what can a flat pack do? A flat pack from IKEA. And what does it mean that the price of solar panels has been reduced from to less than 1% compared to during the 70s, the left graph, and the right graph, the energy of you get from installations of solar panel? Well, for example, instead of a tent camps in Haiti, a tent lasts, in average, 6 months. Then weather and climate breaks it down. You can take a flat pack from IKEA, for example, and you can build a house of hard plastic material, and on the roof you have a sort of metallic fibers that reflects the heat during the day and collects it in the house during the night. And also on the roof you have a solar panel, so you can have a light, You can load your cell phone or the USB memory, whatever, and possibly you can heat your water so you don't get cholera, for example. 600,000 people was infected of cholera in Haiti. Well, you may say, I'm optimistic. Yeah, you are right. I was born optimistic. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your talks. Any comments or questions from the audience? Can come later on with it. I thought just to start a small debate before, Thomas, you start, we will take some, please join us, and we will take some minutes just to speak about these issues. I think it's very interesting that we have Professor Boffert here and Thomas Larsson on the right side, which here are two radicals on these issues, I would say. You did majorly a huge amount of open surgery, trauma surgery, and Thomas is a pioneer in vascular surgery. So first I would like to ask Todd, can you say some words as sitting in the middle? How do you see the future?
Well, I appreciate the challenge. I'll try to do that without offending either the left or the right, which is increasingly difficult in our country, that's for sure. I'm safer in my military uniform. I'm safe from the right and the left. I would say that, you know, it's great. I think, as Professor Boffert mentioned, we learn from the past, and that as far as many of these technologies, they are immature, and we're just beginning our understanding of them. But I think there, at some point, we have to be willing to say we don't want yesterday's standards tomorrow. You know, we joke with some of the curmudgeons in our programs that their motto is yesterday's trauma care tomorrow, you know. And I think we need to be sage and we need to be data-driven. But I also think we want some enthusiasm and to say we don't want yesterday's trauma care tomorrow. We want tomorrow's trauma care tomorrow, and we need to be able to innovate. And I think you know, venues like this are where we're able to, you know, I think put for a couple of hours or maybe a couple of days, the cold hard facts of reality aside. Not we don't throw them out, but we put them aside and we think what's possible through collaboration. I think there's great examples. I love the photograph of the endograft, the aortic endograft. You know, if you look back at the Perotti paper and how, and then even Frank Veith and many of these folks in our vascular, even Norm, Dr. Rich will tell us these stories about one, two, three, four decades ago, not that long ago, really, how these many of these technologies were written off as ludicrous, and now they are their standard of care. So I think, you know, that's the balance, is I think we are informed, we have some cold realism in our approach, but we don't embrace, our motto is not yesterday's trauma care tomorrow. That's not our motto. It's tomorrow's trauma care tomorrow, and let's move forward. So, and I think the arc, I mean, that's why I use the arc of progress. Keep that in mind. I think we're somewhere on that arc, but we're certainly not at the right-hand side of it yet. So,
I think this was a very diplomatic answer as the judge here. And as a talk show manager, Thomas, can you respond on this? Just press the button, down.
On, okay. I think to be successful in the future, you must know your history, because it's not about throwing out something old and replace it with something new. The real brilliant thing is to combine two good things, take the best from the open surgery and the best from the endo. If you do that in a correct way, there will be challenges. Then we will push the envelope and we will find better ways to treat patients. So be aware, know your history to be successful in the future.
Can I ask just before, if Professor Boffert, do you agree with this? I know you want evidence, But can you comment on this before Todd, if it's okay?
I quoted Lord Moynihan in 1901, and I'm going to quote something else he said. He said in 1901, modern surgery is safe for the patient. But he said, the job of the surgeon is to choose the patient safest for that surgery. And I would turn around and say, 117 years later, you take what you've learned and you don't forget it. You always look to the future. And remember, the guy with the blood on him is the patient.
I think one of the things that I would also, I'm glad I remembered this, I think as we look for data, I think that's an important phrase. It's one we should embrace, but it's important to know what type of data we need. And I think we have recognized over the last 10 years that and been commended for the practice of something referred to as focused empiricism, where it's really an engineering approach. It's not the want for a randomized, controlled, blinded study for a cancer drug. This is pragmatic data. This is prospective, observational, pragmatic data, and I think we need to know when it's okay to use that data, especially with devices for hemorrhage control, because doing randomized controlled trials are, one, they're expensive, they are paralyzing often by regulatory means, it's to get consent. So I think getting the right sort of observational data is also something that is so important that as we look for this to gain
Professor Vogel, you?
Thanks again for...
press the button.
Yeah. Thanks again for, as an exotic person, I'm a radiologist, and we have one of the biggest trauma centers in Germany, in Frankfurt, but what I see from the surgical perspective is you had been on the left side very, very depressive on imaging, but what we see now is more the competence. You know, we have vascular surgeons, we have trauma surgeons, we have the thoracic surgeon. But if the patient comes in, who takes care, you know? And we see that more and more we need 24 hours, 7 days a week, these patients have to be cared for. And at least what we see from our imaging, that more and more we separate the patient in the right groups. And I think the future will be who is developing all these techniques, who is really able to provide the techniques 24 hours a day.
Ken, do you want to comment?
I do. I want everybody just to broaden themselves a little bit. We're sitting in one of the world's most sophisticated countries. There's a world outside, and if you look at trauma, of 100% of trauma, probably 5% or less takes place within the realms of the technology that we're talking about. That's not getting the technology, that's having it available even in their country. So that your thinking in trauma must include what do we do in those patients who don't have the technology that we're pushing to the exclusion of anything else. We have to think, you know, our brothers are across the world. Let's just remember all of them.
Thomas.
Yeah, I want to comment. You mentioned, Todd, that the randomized trial is not the way that will take things forward. New ideas don't come up with the randomized trials. But randomized trials are very good to take out old treatment that should not be provided anymore. That's randomized trials good for. You have to go, I will say, when you look at history, the history is like a square. This is what we know, this is what evidence for. And when we face people, patients that will not be well treated within this square, we have to go out the square. That's how new ideas come up. And we present them, we do case reports, we do registries, and so on and so on. That is what gives development.
And I think, just to be clear, I think there's certainly room for randomized studies, so I don't want to be misinterpreted there, but I do bristle at what now we as a medical and scientific community have sort of embraced and fallen in love with, you know, the levels of evidence and randomized controlled, and then we need to do it a couple of times and we're setting these bars for innovation higher and higher to come into our practice. I was at a conference who said there's no data for Reboa, you know, and, you know, these patients need ED thoracotomy. There's, you know, by God, they need their chest opened and their aorta clamped. Well, you know, why is this new bar now necessary for this technique when that bar never existed for 95% of the other techniques we use? So I think we need balance. We need equipoise as we consider what we are, because otherwise we'll defeat ourselves and we will have yesterday's trauma care tomorrow. If we set unrealistic endpoints, unrealistic study designs, unrealistic providers who are doing these, and we don't allot for prospective, pragmatic, observational studies of approved devices. Again, recognizing that 98% of what we do in medicine or surgery never met that bar to date. So now why all of a sudden are we setting a bar that has to be higher and higher? And I think that, in addition to the regulatory agencies doing the same, we really stand to stifle our innovation and progress. It all is in balance. I use the word equipoise. It's not to throw out the controlled studies or abandon regulatory approval. But I do observe us setting an artificially higher and higher bar, demanding, you know, because now we'll get data for Reboa, and then they'll say, well, that's not enough. Well, you got to do we'll do a multi-center study. Now you got to randomize them. You know, and at some point it becomes, I think, encumbering for all our technologies.
Professor Buford, I have a question for you. Let's say that we get this evidence someday, and let's say that we want to change the way of taking care of these critically ill patients. And we remember when the ATLS was introduced to our country, it was not many years ago, and the young instructors' nightmare was those very experienced surgeons that came to the ATLS courses. They were not the believers. So I want to tell you, if there is an evidence is here and we want to change the way of practicing trauma surgery, how do we convince these very experienced surgeons to have another set of mind?
I seem to remember that ATLS was one of the few organizations that it was heavily criticized for not accepting that steroids improved spinal injury. Why didn't you do that? Why didn't you use ATL to put it in ATLS? Because we have yet to be convinced that it's going to make a difference. What is yet to be convinced? When is the threshold of being convinced? I think it's a combination. If you do the DSTC course, what keeps coming through is good judgment comes from experience. Experience comes from bad judgment, hopefully somebody else's. And I think that there will be a trend. I think that you rely on your people who deal with a lot of trauma in different circumstances to make experience-based value judgments. But I think the road in trauma is littered with good intent, which didn't stand up to the test of
I think the answer I want to give you, Arta, is that you collect data and you present data. And by that way, you build competence. I think trauma you can put a graph of the development on how EVAR changed from open repair to now, how aortic aneurysm changed from open repair to EVAR. I would say it took 20 years before the community accepted data that EVAR can be the first line. And you will see the same thing with trauma. Collect data, present them in a good way, and you build competence. That's the way to build confidence.
Can I ask you what you think? Go back to Thomas Vogel's remark on the education. As we, and I think a lot of people here feel the same problem, as we are doing a lot of endovascular procedure, we are not that good, maybe, in open surgery. We have to admit it, some of us. And when you do a lot of catheter technique, maybe theoretically you're not that good as at the same in all the areas. How do you teach people? Who should do these endovascular procedures? Who should do the thoracotomy, the laparotomy, et cetera, et cetera? What do you guys think? Can you give short comments in the last? We have 2 minutes. Can we start with Thomas?
I think there's a high individual in each hospital, even in Germany, we did a lot of surveys in order to check that and who is now responsible. I think mostly we would say the person who can do it best, it depends on the department size. So I think at least interventional radiology is very active in the trauma care in Germany. We have a lack of vascular surgeons, so all the endovascular procedures are mainly done in radiology.
So I will say that in trauma, you gather all the people that in a way can contribute. And then the first step is to change the mindset. When you change the mindset, you can change the skill set.
To be brief, as usually or often happens, I had a great idea posed to me by Johnny Morrison last night, and it always is after the second beer, Johnny's here. You know, I think we should set out guidelines. I think there should be three tiers of endovascular trained individuals: tier one, tier two, and tier three. Tier three are the most. They're tier one are the most trained. They're the endovascular surgeons who do this all the time. Tier two are a middle tier that have some training. Tier three, you know, are less. But I think organizations like this can put out guidelines that sort of help organize. They don't create dogma, but they help this community that is struggling with that question with some guidance. And I think, you know, kudos to Johnny for that idea or others out there who may have, I think we could put that together and help guide the practice. Just as we've done, the SVS has done for carotid stenting, for some of the, for EVARs and other areas of intervention where in their earliest phases, the profession and the different specialties need some help in guiding that, so.
Shortly.
Why do we have to reinvent the wheel? The gynecologists knew about ultrasound and sonar 100 years, or feels like it, before surgeons. And it took a long time before surgeons, kind of an emergency room doctors, adopted sonar. I think it's going to be exactly the same with this. They're going to be enthusiasts. They're going to run with the technique. That will spread. There will be new indications and new enthusiasts. And that's why we're here.
All right. Thank you so much.
So we go ahead with the next lecture, Professor Vogel from Frankfurt. He's the head of radiology department, and his main interest is in interventional radiology. Please.
Yeah, dear Tal, thanks audience for inviting me to participate at that very interesting meeting. I want to share with you the data, and as you see from my co-authors, Department of Anesthesiology, trauma surgeons are well involved. What is the concept in our Frankfurt tertiary care center? You see here, of course, our trauma suit, and we always start with chest X-ray and ultrasound according to the FAST protocol. Then in the polytrauma patients, if the patients are more or less stable, we go to the CT scan, maybe a difference to South Africa. And then, of course, we have the following tools we will mention later. I want to pick out one portion where I think interventions are of very high importance. And together with my trauma surgeon, my friend Ingo Marzi, we have a study running on the pelvic fractures. And there, again and again, there is a discussion regarding the optimal management in these patients. And there is a big discussion on should we do pelvic angiography or should we first start with pelvic packing, and I will show you some of the data we have obtained. What is a major bleeding sources in pelvic fractures? We know it's a fracture site. We have a lot of venous problem, like we heard today, in these patients, and arterial bleeding is coming from these arteries, as I will mention later. And, of course, we have the possibility to have a C-clamp or external fixator, and we have a lot of interventional procedures we can perform, we can provide, and of course this has to be done then 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. So in these patients, if you have acute bleeding in this area, embolization is one of the tools we are offering, and the secondly is a primary stent application. All types of stents are available 24 hours, covered, non-covered, and of course also protocols for treating dissections are important. We have currently a registry all over Germany in all trauma centers, and there we are evaluating, and still we have a high role of performing X-ray. You will see in a lot of centers now we have just CT scans, but it's very important. It's a fast scan. Within 3 seconds, the image is there. Then we have the different protocols for CT, like we heard today, invasive angiography and interventional radiology has to be available 24 hours. Otherwise, it will not make any clinical impact on these patients. And what is important also, that we have a low-sensitive ultrasound in the later follow-up, while the fast scan is, of course, of high importance. Here, if you have the rating, we see still that conventional X-ray is important, ultrasound screening for hematoperitoneum is important, and then CT scan comes with a lower intention, and of course, we need all these informations. There are a huge variety of embolization material. We have as a rule that people should use the technique they are most convenient, especially in the trauma situation. You can divide them in non-spherical particles or PVA, the spherical particles. We have temporary particles, which we like, especially if you are going to the intestines. We have fluids, like we heard today, different coils available from currently 15 companies in Germany. But it's important you have them, you have to be able to use them. You know what is happening if these coils are going in the wrong organs. Of course, you will try to avoid it. Let's start with a typical situation. Even in Frankfurt, it's a very criminal city, but sometimes also people fall down here from 3 meters. You see here the CT scan, the fracture, the hematoma. I think still CT is of a value. Also, we heard it differently. You see the type of fracture. You see here the bleeding. And the angiography shows you several important findings. Here we see, first of all, that here from the lumbar artery is coming a bleeding, which is nicely depicted here. And the second one is also coming here from the first branch of the internal iliac artery. All this was immediately accessed, procedure of 10, 12 minutes. And then we are able to perform superselective embolizations, combining particles and coils in these patients. Traumatic aortic rupture, also we heard, within normally several minutes, we should be able, like in this patient, you see a not very nice CT scan from a peripheral hospital. And if you then see during angiography, you see here the typical aneurysm, and we have always stents available within 10 minutes. They should be placed here in the right position in this patient in order to stabilize the situation. What is important for our trauma management, that we have to see what is the decision-making process. We cannot perform embolizations or stenting in all patients. If we are taking, we have a very important dividing in our hospital, which we call them responders, transient responders, or non-responders. Non-responders means they need immediate surgery with stabilization, C-clamps, packing, and maybe the option of a secondary embolization. We have the transient responders. They are initially stabilized, and then they can go to the angio suite, and if we have an arterial blush, we perform angioembolization and orthopedic stabilization. And if it's more venous, we can also, like we heard today on the balloons, we have that available, we can discuss it also further. We evaluated here pelvic fractures in Frankfurt, and you see we counted 173 different types of fractures, and you see that in the majority, even in pelvic fractures, you don't need extra invasive procedures, therapy minima in these patients. Surgical management in 21% of these patients, and out of these, you see in 16 patients, we were called in order to perform angiography or angiography embolization. And you see here a lot of variety in the pelvic, and again, it needs the expertise. You have to know all these vessels in the pelvic in order to be able to access them, and especially lumbar artery can be a major challenge, sacral artery, and you see all these different fractures involve different arteries. So it means a lot of anatomical knowledge in these patients. Here, a patient here shown also in this example here with a huge bleeding here. You see the extravasation of the contrast agent. And you see in 19 patients, we have been able to stabilize with packing, and the mortality still in these patients is quite high, with 1 of 3 in these patients. Another example, an 8-year-old patient jumped out of the first floor window. We have seen a type C pelvic injury. It was a non-responder, but due to persistent blood transfusion, it became a responder. You see here the internal iliac artery. You see a very small vessel going up here. You see the extravasation of contrast agent. Here we perform an immediate coiling. We have the remittent coiling system, which means we are able to chemically display and deport then the coil in order to stabilize the situation. So that's our primary survey in Frankfurt. So we are, of course, working to the ATLS system. And if we have the responders, the patient are going to the multi-slice CT, contrast enhanced with a very defined standardized protocol. And then the patient, if he has a contrast blush, we go to angio embolization. If he don't have a contrast blush, we don't go to angiography, angiography embolization. Mostly it's venous, and there we cannot contribute substantially in order to document it. So what is important at the time point of embolization, here a study here already published in 1997, and the data are not so far advanced, meanwhile, shows you that if we have an immediate embolization, we have a lower and a lower mortality and an increase for the patient. So in summary, I want to access again my thanks to the different colleagues. And you see here, it's not only the surgeons. We need the nurses, the anesthesiologists, and all these different colleagues in order to help together. And in Frankfurt, we have a very joint venture. We are training every 4 weeks all the people in the emergency room in order to document this. And if you are interested, we perform a lot of CT scans and evaluate the patients, train other colleagues, and I think that's the future. Thank you again for inviting me here, and I'm open for any types of discussions. Thank you.
Please, Professor Vogel, have a seat, please, with us. Just a minor comment to the audience. We're going to have to go ahead with the lectures, and just before the short break, we're going to have some questions, if you have any, to the lecture holders. So let's go ahead with the next talk, and it's Professor Samokhvarov from Russian Federation. He's a deputy surgeon-in-chief of Russian Army. He is a vascular and trauma surgeon who was deployed in Afghanistan during the war. Please.
Thank you. Dear Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, general officers, a great honor and privilege for me to speak at this international high professional and future looking symposium. Disclosure, disclaimer, of course. I have remote experience from 1990s after pioneers' work of Carl Hughes. We have some experience in civilian conditions. Research of experimental reboa with my assistant Anatoly Zavrazhnov, now he's professor and he is our symposium. And 10 civilian patients in extremis with OR operation room reboa at zone 1, and one patient survived. The objective of this report, based on the Russian experience of combat vascular trauma, to define where and how endovascular and hybrid surgery can be used in combat environment. Our combat vascular trauma experience consists of about 1,000 casualties in different operations. Modern combat trauma data bank of our department used in my report too. The proportion of explosive vascular injuries in these conflicts has increased significantly. Here are combat vascular injury patterns. Blast vascular injuries were most dangerous, of course. The environment of deployed Royal II medical treatment facilities often were difficult. Working conditions of forward Royal III hospitals were much better, but one of this hospital in Mosdok was blown up by enemy attack, and vascular surgeon Professor Zavrazhnov was in this hospital and lived. Evacuation time to Royal II was almost 4 hours in Afghanistan, and about 1.5 hours in the Caucasus. Primary surgeries performed in Role 2 medical treatment facilities to vascular casualties included ligations, arterial repairs, temporary shunting and primary amputation, of course. Up to 60% of vascular casualties recovered in these combat conditions. About 30% were retired. Total retaliatory rate was about 10%. And how to define where and how endovascular and hybrid surgery can be used in these conditions. On my opinion, pre-hospital simplified reboa at role one has a good prospect. The frequency of critical combat injuries at role one on our data was about 3%. Also, in fact, the real number of these casualties may be much more as they die from internal bleeding in the pre-MTF environment. Next, forward reboa and role two. The frequency of critical combat casualties delivered to role two was about 1%. The frequency of severe combat casualties delivered to role two was about 10%, and about half of them had serious abdominal and pelvis injuries with severe bleeding. And role three reboa. The frequency of critical combat casualties delivered to role three was about 1.5%. The frequency of combat abdominal casualties delivered to role three was 4.5% and 0.5% were critical. The frequency of combat pelvis injuries was about 3.5% and 0.3% of them were critical. The rate of vascular injury in modern combat was 9% and more. 30% of arterial injuries occur to arteries of extremities considered minor or distal. So the modern approach to combat endovascular and hybrid surgery consists of pre-hospital reboa, more than 3% of wounded injections, forward MTF reboa, up to 5% or more of casualties, and role three reboa, emergency department reboa, is indicated to 1.5 casualties. Operation room reboa may be used at 10% abdominal and pelvis wounded. Endovascular and hybrid surgery can be used at 70% of vascular injuries or 5% to 8% of all battle casualties. In low intensive conflicts with role two MTF locations in one place, as in Afghanistan war, it becomes possible pushing forward C-arms and endovascular surgery too. However, so far endovascular opinion, endovascular operations on major arteries in combat environments is mainly the role three property. I thank Tal Horer and other organizers for the excellent AVTM symposium. Thank you.
Please have a seat with us here if you want to. And then we go on with the next lecture. It's Professor Benjamin Starrs. He's a professor of vascular surgery, and he's the chief of the division of the vascular surgery and vice chair of the department of the surgery of University of Washington. Please.
May we ask Thomas Vogel also to join us in the panel here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Tal, for the kind invitation to be here. I really am delighted to come all the way from Seattle to be able to share some of our experience with managing ruptured aortic aneurysms using remote balloon occlusion. These are my disclosures. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a patient with a ruptured abdominal aortic aneurysm, and I call your attention to the relaxed posture of the surgeon in the room. This was over 15 years ago in the year 2002. The patient was an 81-year-old who had a ruptured aortic aneurysm. His hematocrit was 21. He was still mentating, so we brought him into the operating room and placed this aortic occlusion balloon. We then asked our anesthesia colleagues to go ahead and put him to sleep. They induced anesthesia, and his pressure tanked down into the 50s, as it normally does. And I inflated the balloon, and his pressure came up. And the anesthesiologist looked at me and said, oh, it was just the induction agent, nothing else. And I said, well, let's test that hypothesis. I have a clamp on his aorta. And he looked over the screen, and he said, no, you haven't even started yet. You haven't even opened up the abdomen. So I said, well, let's test your hypothesis. I let the balloon down. His pressure tanked. And I said, let's not test that hypothesis anymore. Let's go ahead and open his abdomen. So we did, and this is what we found: a ruptured 12-centimeter abdominal aortic aneurysm and about 3 liters of blood in his abdomen. This was a free rupture of an aortic aneurysm. This gentleman survived to go home and live the rest of his days with his daughter. We collected a series of about 5 patients and published this article entitled Clamp Before You Cut: Proximal Aortic Control with Balloon Occlusion. The first documented aortic occlusion balloon performed at Harborview Medical Center, where I work in Seattle, Washington, was done on August 17, 2006 by one of my colleagues, Todd Vogel. In 2014, we collected a series of 69 aortic occlusion balloons placed for ruptured aortic aneurysms, and these are those individual snapshots of each of those patients. And we published an article entitled Management of Ruptured Abdominal Aortic Aneurysm in the Endovascular Era. In that paper, we showed that we were able to lower our mortality rate overall from 57% to 25%, and for those patients who were lucky enough to undergo endovascular repair, the mortality rate was only 16%. This is a revolutionary change in the way we manage patients with ruptured aortic aneurysms. This is a dramatic example. In September of 2008, I had a patient, 79-year-old male, acute onset of abdominal pain. His family called 911. Medic 1 arrived. That's our pre-hospital system in Seattle. He was hypotensive with a blood pressure of 70, and he was fluid responsive. So on arrival, he had a heart rate of 90, a blood pressure of 92, and was normothermic. So we got this CT scan. This is a ruptured 12.5-centimeter abdominal aortic aneurysm, and these iliac arteries are no walk in the park either. So we brought him down to the operating room, and we placed this aortic occlusion balloon. The anesthesiologists really were just aching to put an endotracheal tube in this patient, and I just said, hold off. He was frothing at the mouth. He was pale, and he was becoming bradycardic. We all know what that means, that he was about to die. We accessed him, put this aortic occlusion balloon in, and almost instantaneously, he got color in his cheeks. His cheeks became pink. He woke up. He grabbed his oxygen mask, pulled it off of his face, and said, where am I? What am I doing here? It's amazing what happens when you perfuse the brain with blood. You can see what, this is his anesthesia sheet right here. He came in with his blood pressure barely detectable, bradycardic, becoming more and more bradycardic, down into the 50s. And then all of a sudden, his pressure shot up to 200, and he stayed rock stable throughout the rest of the operation. Here's a follow-up CT scan of that patient a week later, showing complete exclusion of that aneurysm using endovascular means. Lessons learned from managing patients with ruptured aortic aneurysms, we always use either local anesthesia or no anesthesia. Sometimes these patients are in profound hemodynamic collapse and circulatory shock, and they don't feel a needle going into their femoral artery. Pre-close, or using a closure device, is a luxury in a stable patient. We don't use pre-close if the patient is unstable. And the aortic occlusion balloon should always go in through the straightest iliac. It's not why you think. The reason that is that if you're managing the patient with an endovascular approach, you have to cannulate the contralateral gate. You want that gate cannulation to go very smoothly and efficiently, and that's why we put the aortic occlusion balloon up from the straightest side, because that will be the side of your contralateral gate. So how can we increasingly apply endovascular techniques to patients presenting with trauma, either blunt or penetrating? And how can we make the placement of an aortic occlusion balloon easier? We designed a one-shot aortic occlusion balloon several years ago. It had some nice features to it. It could be inserted blindly. It had a unique pop-off valve that would not go higher than 2 atmospheres. And unfortunately, Cook Incorporated decided not to proceed with development of this balloon. However, we tested it in pigs and it worked beautifully. Our Harborview protocol is that the trauma surgery attendings and fellows were required to watch a video on femoral access with ultrasound, and were required to scrub in with us and perform 5 routine common femoral artery access procedures. We have an aortic occlusion balloon dedicated pager that's carried by the on-call vascular resident or fellow who are trained in vascular access. We have an aortic occlusion balloon set with all of our supplies and the resuscitation bays, and we own the access site. No matter who gets the access, once they get access and the patient has been stabilized, vascular surgery owns the access site. Here is a patient that I managed in 2010 with a famous trauma surgeon by the name of Jerry Jerkovich. It was a man who was shot during a holdup of a 7-Eleven. He was shot in his left distal thigh, and the track of the missile went from his right up his adductor canal and lodged behind his left kidney here. When I met the patient, he was in hemodynamic collapse. His abdomen was tense. There were 5 anesthesia providers in the room pounding blood into him, and he was about to die. So Jerry Jerkovich asked me to scrub in and put an aortic occlusion balloon in because he thought this was a lethal injury. This took about 10 minutes to assemble all of the gear we needed. We put this aortic occlusion balloon in, and look at this profile. So his heart rate was almost 190, and his blood pressure was non-detectable. I told everyone in the room, we need to wait 10 minutes. 10 minutes in an operating room is an eternity. We allowed his heart rate to come down, his blood pressure to come up. Then we opened his abdomen and found 5 liters of blood. This is the aortic occlusion balloon. His injury was right behind his left inguinal ligament. He had taken out his common femoral artery and vein. And that indeed was a non-survivable Black Hawk Down type injury. That patient survived. So ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, an update on Codistat. It's not currently available, unfortunately, but we have other alternatives, as Dr. Rasmussen described earlier. Can these balloons be placed blindly? Yes. Who can use it? Vascular surgeons, interventionalists, trauma surgeons, and vascular residents and fellows. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Ben. I would like to hear if there are any comments, questions, remarks. I would love it if you people take the microphone. There are some microphones maybe on the side. You can start.
Okay, maybe one question. You showed the huge aneurysm, and there was a small neck of the aneurysm. How you were certain that you managed to come up the through the aneurysmal neck? You have always a special X-ray in the trauma room, so you have a special angiographic machine, or because normally we have only a chest X-ray or maybe a CT scanner.
I think, is this on? Yeah, so all of these patients were managed in an operating theater, either a hybrid OR or in the operating room with a portable C-arm. So none of these patients had, for a ruptured aortic aneurysm, they were going to go to the OR anyway. Okay. So none of them had balloons placed in the ED. We do have a protocol now where we've treated about a dozen patients in the emergency department with aortic occlusion balloons placed for trauma, but I haven't shared that experience. My task was to talk about ruptures.
Let's take some comments, please. Just present your name, please, also, everybody.
Yes, this is Joe DeBose from the United States. Wonderful talks, and my compliments to you, Tal, on a wonderful program thus far. My question is for my colleague from the United States, Dr. Starnes. So, you know, one of the things we're struggling with the utilization of Rebroa currently is who should be doing it. And there's been a clamoring in the United States from the emergency department community. I wondered, can you take and extrapolate some of the successes that you've demonstrated at Washington incorporating the trauma surgeons and build other members, including interventional radiology and emergency medicine providers, into some of the team, if you will, that's capable of at least getting access and potentially placing some of these lower profile devices? Is that a reasonable goal in your mind?
I think it absolutely is. It's the future. And thank you for your comments, Joe. The way our protocol works is the most experienced provider in the room with femoral access is the one getting the access. This is not a teaching moment. Most of the time. These are patients that are either in shock or they're transient responders, and they need perfect access. And so whether that be an interventional radiologist, there are some trauma surgeons who are champions for this, and they want to be involved, but quite honestly, most trauma surgeons in America in big academic institutions, they have a series of schedules where they're the ICU attending for 2 weeks, and then they go into their lab for 4 weeks, and then they take 2 weeks of trauma call. So they're only exposed to these patients every 3 or 4 months. And so they're not going to become good at femoral access if they're living that sort of schedule. We now have a CT surgeon that's very proactive. We have an ECMO program at Harborview. And so he's very good at getting access. He's always there. We have vascular fellows and residents that are always available. So I think we just need to come together as a team. But you're absolutely right. The vascular access sets the tone for the entire resuscitation.
Joe, please.
Sure. Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. Joe Love from Houston, Texas. Quick question. This is kind of goes to the last panel and this panel as well. On the side of Afghanistan, I think there's a handful of people in the room that have pictures exactly the same locations at different times than you showed earlier. We are now facing a different sort of environment, and Dr. Larson, your comments about the idea of global casualties or mass casualties, a lot of what we're talking about now are high expense, high cost, and in many cases, like you just said, Dr. Starnes, high skill set in order to pull some of these things off. In Houston, we've toyed with cannulation by ECMO with some of our pre-hospital personnel, whether it be nurses or even paramedics, to get them out to the field. How do we reconcile this idea of these high-cost, individualized care when we have a big concern of maybe a mass terrorist attack or something like that?
Well, I'll comment on that. That's a very difficult question to answer. I think, you know, having had 3 combat tours myself, when you have a mass casualty scenario like that, they're going to be people that die. We're talking about managing patients with profound injuries using advanced techniques. Those patients, we're not going to be doing that in a mass casualty situation. We're going to be applying tourniquets and doing buddy aid and identifying those patients who are the walking wounded and could be litter bearers, that sort of thing. But it is a terrifying thing now that we have ISIS that has capabilities of using drones. They're actually using drones in Iraq right now to attack coalition forces. So it's coming. It's going to be upon us.
I want to take this a bit further. When we organized this, I've been thinking, has any knowledge about multiple injured and EVTM? And I think we have some people here from Israel, for example, Boris, Ofer, Michael, different people that maybe want to comment. What's the option, and you guys, of course, when you have more than one person, we talk about RIBOA, whatever, more than one room, you need more than one suite. Can you comment on this? And I would love to know also, Igor, if you have some thoughts about how it should work when you have multiple patients in Russia also. How would you manage this?
So triage is the most good for the most patients, and the senior-most surgeon should be the person triaging patients, at least in this scenario. In our scenario at Harborview, when we have a rupture going on or a case going on in our hybrid room and all of our angio suites are occupied, we go into the next available room and we use a portable C-arm and put the patient on an imaging table. So we're always constantly flexing to the tempo, the battle rhythm, so to speak.
Any comments here? We have a lot of microphones, just
Hello, Mickey Stein from Israel. I'm working at the Rabin Medical Center. You asked about mass casualties. We had quite a few of those with suicide bombers. And actually, our protocols state that you should not do that thing in a mass casualty situation. However, I think one of the papers we wrote about 25 or 26 mass casualty incidents, at least two or three of them, when you had more than 50 patients at the same time, after the first round that you make, and that takes about 2 hours, you find out that there's not very many who are critically injured. Initially, you don't know who they are. So in the lower, and it depends on the hospital you're working in. The amount of capabilities that you mentioned in Harborview is something that's utopia in Israel. I don't think we have that. And we have several of our guys who went through Harborview, and when they came back and said, we can't, you have a lot of money to do that. We don't. Maybe we'll get some from the United States, but...
okay.
Only in one of the mass casualties that I was involved in, one of the 26 mass casualties incidents in the hospital, only in one of them I could pick up one patient that could be helped by an endovascular procedure like that. So it's quite rare. But in the basic issue is that you should not do that in a mass casualty, otherwise you'll lose other patients.
Boris?
Yeah. Boris Kessel, Israel also. You know, we always, as for you, Dr. Storms, we always argue with our American colleagues. In mass casualty triage, we really believe that triage must be done not by trauma surgeon, because the most experienced surgeon should be in OR, not in emergency room, not in the door on the hospital. In 30 seconds, even the most experienced one missed. And we know that missed injuries is about 30, even maybe more, 40%. So if you have 3, 4, 5 severely injured patients, you have to put them emergency to OR, the most experienced one should be in OR, not in an emergency room. Mm-hmm. What Dr. Stein saying, EVTM in mass casualty event, I agree and not agree. Because my answer is we don't know. We don't know, really don't know. Maybe in this situation, we will buy a bridge to next patient. We do a lot of abbreviated laparotomies in such scenario. So maybe you may buy bridge to another procedure. We don't know. Hopefully, we will don't know in the future. Yeah, but I think we have no answer what to do with EVTM in mass casualty events. Don't know.
Any comments from you guys?
Yeah, I'm just quoting U.S. military doctrine. That's all. It's orders.
I didn't know that. Any more comments here? Please.
And one more comment, maybe. You present the case with a severe, huge bleeding in the belly. The patient was with unmeasurable blood pressure, and you deal like 10 minutes with a balloon. If you ask all trauma surgeons what you do with patient with no blood pressure to open the belly or to put the balloon...
He would have died. He would have died. So Jerry Jerkovich, one of the most seasoned trauma surgeons in America, looked at me and said, if I open his belly, he's going to die. And he knew he had already exsanguinated into his abdomen from that wound. And so he thought that his only chance was to get that balloon in. Okay. So we did that, and he lived.
So my question is, next time, is that what you will recommend to your fellow to do?
So I don't think there's anybody that could have gone in his belly faster than Jerry Jerkovich. You know?
Let's continue.
Hello, I'm Rico Hoenkamp from the Netherlands. I have a question for our Russian
colleague. Please increase.
Actually. Do you hear me or not? I have a question for our Russian colleague. I'm Rico Hoenkamp from the Netherlands. I'm actually quite interested in the story you told us about the MTF1. And I think the most prominent role for the REBOA should be in the pre-hospital phase. So I'm not quite sure about the definition you use for the MTF1. Because I think if you mix the pre-hospital phase with the MTF1, I think the time aspect gets quite important. So is there a definition change in here, or Is it better to go from the pre-hospital phase straight to the role two or the role three?
Okay, I ask. The definition is simple. Pre-hospital RIBO is RIBO without fluoroscopic control. Blind injection of balloon catheter to zone one.
May I make a comment? So I think the place, that's a great question. I totally agree with you. If we had better ways of teaching people to get reliable femoral access, the pre-hospital setting would be the place to get access. I don't know about putting a balloon in and occluding the aorta, because then I think we're going to kill patients if we start doing that. But I think the place to start is in the inter-hospital transfer. That's an opportunity where you have, because most of our ruptures come from other hospitals around our area. They see the patient with a ruptured aneurysm or with, for that matter, very significant blunt or penetrating trauma that they can't handle at their hospital. So, but you have capable people in that hospital that can get vascular access, that can put a balloon in, and can manage that patient. If they were to crash during transfer, they could potentially, you know, save a life. But I think that's the next frontier, is that inter-hospital transfer, and then we go full-blown into the field.
No, I absolutely agree on your part, but I think if you're talking in military setting, the time aspects, if you have an error medevac from a pre-hospital phase to an MTF1, place a REBOA, and then go,
and then
to,
go
the
to the exit. Cache,
and
right.
I think that's why I ask if it's a definition issue, or I misunderstand.
Maybe provocative, and I'll ask you, if you're standing there and you have one room or your resources are limited, would you use this technology to get time? Which, I mean, for example, you're a knight, you have one operation place, you have one team, it's occupied. Would you use it to win time? For example, REBOA, partial REBOA. Hypothetically, would you comment on this?
Yes, we use this technology in swine model. And my colleague Victor Reva will tell about it in the next session. Thank you.
But just remember, you can't have a balloon above the celiac artery for longer than 25 or 30 minutes or you'll have a dead patient. I mean, 25 or 30 minutes of hepatic, warm hepatic ischemia, and they're done. They're completely coagulopathic and their liver's not going to function. They're not going to clot their blood. So
I have a comment on that. Per Skog, Gothenburg, Sweden. When I started with ABO or REBOA, we did it in hospital. We could help our gynecology colleagues with the massive bleeding postpartum or so. And it was full occluded balloons. And I was very scared because as a vascular surgeon, bleeding is one thing, I can handle that, but thrombosis is really nasty. But I don't agree, because I think that I can make a stenosis in the aorta to increase perfusion above the semi-inflated balloon and to decrease the pressure below. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, we have a lot of research to do, but and thrombosis is a problem, but maybe you can increase survival during transfer, and I think that an hour is not a problem.
Well, I think if it's all about positioning of the balloon in the different zones of the aorta. I mean, if you put the balloon in the thoracic aorta for longer than 30 minutes, your patient's dead.
No. If it's fully inflated, yes.
Yeah.
But if it's semi-inflated, you just create a stenosis and you perfuse the brain and the heart and you lower the pressure to the bleeding site. So that's another thought.
Okay.
Thomas, and then Joe, I think you're standing there.
I really don't agree we on this. I think we cannot say it's 20 minutes or 40 minutes. Actually, the first series we presented on ruptured aneurysm, we had a very aggressively use of a occlusion balloon. We don't do it anymore, but during the 2001-2005 series, the medium occlusion time for zone two was 40 minutes, the median time. And actually, 87% of the patients that we treated survived. So either my brain is tired or you count wrong.
quick response, or Joe, you guys decide.
But maybe a question on you reporting about partial inflation of the balloon. Are there any data on that? Is there an effect?
It's coming. We will. Some of us will report. Others will report. Joe.
Yeah, so just a quick question about access, particularly removal of the sheath. And I wanted to ask Dr. Starnes and our interventional colleagues, on removal, we're now moving to lower profile 7 French 8 French devices. In some settings that I've worked in the elective setting, we have a nurse practitioner team that goes around and removes those devices if it's 8 French or lower. Is that now, is the lower profile going to change the policy in Washington? And what do they do in other environments?
Yeah, so we use a 12 French sheath for our aortic occlusion balloon, and it's a long 12 French sheath. So we cut down and fix all of those at the end, unless we have the luxury of placing a suture-mediated closure device ahead of time. But I think the lower profile devices are going to be easier to get manual control over. Tom, you want to?
No. Yep. I think the same. The important thing is it should be available, and what type you are using.
I think we will find ourselves in this situation if it's mass casualty or just several patients. We will find ourselves in a situation, for example, that you will have a Reboa patient waiting for some solution. It's very exciting, but we will see. We have to stop now?
Yeah, I think we've come to the end of this session. We'll like to thank all the lecture holders for very nice talks. And actually, we are very happy that you have great discussions, and I think that it's the way to go. We hope for better discussions, and
we'll continue
about 15 minutes, so it's going to be a short break. Thank you.
Thank you.